departments are requesting from the years 2010 to 2014 these various projects, which at this point we neither endorse nor condemn, but they're out there, so they want to be done, and we'll deal with them year after year.
That's I guess I think it should be clarified so people understand what those numbers mean, because there is a sense of, well, gee, you guys said we were going to buy this truck or this or that, because look, it's here on this sheet, but it's not on the sheet. It's on the sheet because we're trying to, you know, make sure that people see what the six-year plan might look like if we had to do all these things.
Maybe it would be helpful if we made the document clearer.
Yeah, that's what I was saying.
Some sort of narrative on that. Narrative and stuff in the budget to make that clear.
And certainly it's open for discussion. I mean, there's no reason we can't discuss. If there's a question going out in any department, we should be able to talk about it. So.
And I think Johnny, you're right. I think that this provides a very useful tool for planning purposes, so that in next year's budget, if we want to make a deposit towards something that's here 4 or 5 years out, you know, we can look at this and say, all right, this is what we'll do now to prepare for that then.
And if you allow me to box the compass, if you look at the last page of the summary sheet, another way to look at this is that the total of all these projects are $19.5 million, with $9.4 million for FY09. And another way to look at all of this is, can we really take on $9.4 million when over the course of 6 years we're looking at $19.6 million? Or is there some need, as some of us see it, to spread this out over a longer period of time?
Well, that's why I guess I would like to make it a little more clear to the taxpayer that you're not necessarily saying that you're going to spend $29 million. You haven't proved $28 million. You're just saying here's what's out there to be thought about, you know, and this is the request. I think you're right, Matt. This is the request, but this doesn't mean necessarily we're going to spend more or less. Who knows which way it's going to go.
Maybe on the summary page.
I'll try to think of some suggestions.
If there's a question, just refer them to that. Maybe that will clarify one of the things. Okay. I'll
start.
Yeah,
but I know
what you're
Adam.
Yes. I've got a post from you.
Patience.
What's that without any name?
No. If Bradley dies here, I'm in trouble. Okay.
How do I word this? I guess you're chairing this meeting.
I heard a question from Dr. Sapkin, excuse me, about what is a skag mower, because it's a big part of what you're doing here. But you're looking at, just talk, what is a skag mower, for example?
It's the first one, the first page, 1600 skag mower. It's a 2000. Purchased in 2000, it's 61 inches wide, cuts predominantly the cemetery on Route 67, all small spots throughout the entire town, all the ball fields. And I'm requesting to replace it in 2010. It's going to be 10 years old. It's starting to get pretty old, it's burning oil, the deck is starting to wear, it's a problematic mower. It seems like every time I try to start it, it doesn't start. I feel like it's getting about that time, and around 2010 to replace it.
That mower last year, we thought was 19. Did you get a better handle on that at this point? Is that why we got 24?
I'm asking for a. It was 19. I'm asking for a catcher to pick up the grass.
I'm sorry.
Because I'm getting into the middle of the season where the grass is growing so much that we're actually raking the field by hand. It would be a lot easier for the acrylic instead of
I didn't realize that's why I got it.
Picking up the grass by hand, raking it, you know, the entire field that they're laying from. Literally rake and try to, you know, pile it as best we can, and then drive a truck out there and road and truck and haul it out. We do that almost every week. It only happens in the summer. There's a lot of grass to grow, and the grass dries quickly. It doesn't decompose like the spring and fall, so in the summer it dries out quick, and it just stays there. It'd be a big help to have that attached to it.
I just didn't know what the difference was.
I know it also helped to pick up the leaves in the past.
So you're saying buying this in the summer, like June of 2010? Is that how you have this? Because you got it half this year and half next year?
It's just spreading it out.
Spreading it out over the 2 years.
You'll make it without it? Excuse me, that other one will survive? You said it's giving you problems.
There's two skags. When I, yeah. They're both giving me problems. They're not top of the line mowers. They're not. These landscapers have the zero radius mowers, and they last not that long. I mean, 10 years is the top of these things. Yeah, and you got to remember they're almost going every day.
Yeah.
Well, should we be buying something of a better quality?
Toro. That's the company name.
Is that what this one is?
No, this is a Skag mower, the Toro mower. We have two Toro mowers, and they're much better. Everything about it is heavy duty.
How much is the difference in the cost?
That is the price to cover it. It's not purchasing another Skag.
Oh, okay. Well, this
with
is
a Toro
to purchase
mower.
The Toro.
Yeah. Okay. And the reason I know that is because I was a golf course superintendent, and we had just about John Deere, Skag, Toro, and everything that lasted the longest was Toro. All right.
The acquisition date on the first sheet is 2000, but on the next sheet it's 1999. Is it the use that makes this one?
It is. We use it much more. It had a blown motor, and it's burning oil a lot. It seems like every week I put at least a quart of oil in the motor, and that's not good. So, and again, that's the Skag, and it's a nice mower, but it's not top of the line. It won't last like a Toro should.
Too bad they don't make the locks anymore.
They lasted forever.
Yeah.
And they weighed a ton, but they're, you know.
And they were right down in Bridgeport.
That's right.
Boy, those are real mowers.
Those are real mowers?
Those are
rotary mowers, yeah.
They're real mowers. The sharp ones.
It's a pebble neck. It's for fine cut turf, like a golf course. If you had a pebble or anything, you're dead. So all our mowers are rotary mowers.
Yeah, and I guess the rest of your requests go out a couple of years. Your next one is FY11. Most of theirs is equipment.
Yeah,
repainting of the tennis courts. Right. Are there any questions on any of these other items? Out in 12 and 13, another Toro mower, that's a big one, I guess, $50,000.
Yep. That's the mower I asked 4 years ago to, instead of hiring two employees, just hire one.
Yeah.
And that takes the place of an employee, so that saves the town a lot of money.
Is that one in decent shape?
It had some trouble this year. The gearbox that drives the mower blades, it broke on us. And it's a $1,500 part. It's not cheap.
Now, when something like that happens, you fix it yourself, or you have to send it to a dealer?
We have the mechanics fix it, or we replace it. If it's out of their realm, we replace it. And it broke us.
So are there any other questions? I mean, again, I think all the rest of these years going out are pretty much self-explanatory. And if there's any other questions for Adam?
Do we not why are we taking out, I guess?
Well, I drained the pool this August completely.
Uh-huh.
And I don't know if you recall, I was gonna have a contractor come in and do a pool inspection. And we did the inspection. And we were not fully able to determine the extent of the damage within the scupper drains. We did determine that the drains at this time did not require immediate attention. There was damage inside these scupper drains and the main drains. But years prior to that, I had worked on all the drains and put in a special compound within the main drains to stop the deterioration. And he said that was a good idea. Now this gentleman, Glenn Sorgero's Pools, has been working on this pool for 15 years. He taught me everything I did, I know about that pool. So he wrote a report and he said, for the time being, don't do anything, keep an eye out. So instead of asking for $35,000 and just arbitrarily ripping out all the scupper drains because we see a little deterioration is not the way to go. I'd rather come up with a different plan, relook at it, maybe in FY13, because about every 3 years I drain the pool, and we'll look at it again. And being that Len taught me everything I need to know about how to run an indoor huge pool, filtration, electrical, all there is to know, I'll determine then whether or not I should start saving 5 years from FY13.
Okay.
So I didn't see any reason to spend that money. I wasn't convinced, and neither was Lenny. And he did inspect the entire pool. He looked at the filtration system, he looked at the walls, the floor, the block walls, the paint. The pool's in very good condition. So I can't see or figure out any reason. I've looked at everything in that pool. There's really nothing I need for a long time.
That's fine. I just didn't see it, and saw it last year, and I was just concerned that, are we missing something? That's all.
Yeah, no, I took it out. I didn't see any need for it. Now, I've had contractors look at that pool, and everybody said, keep an eye on it. You ought to start thinking about saving money for that. And after having Lenny come in, this contractor, I felt it was Lenny and I determined to watch it. It looks pretty good. There are things that I can do to the pool, those drains, to prolong that for until I drain it the next time, and that'll be at least 3 years from now, at least.
We hope.
So this $5,000, this is sort of like a reserve.
A reserve fund. A motor pump could easily cost $10,000. That pump and that motor is specific for a pool only. I looked into getting an energy efficient motor because that runs nonstop, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, to save money. You can't get that. You have to buy a pump specifically made for a certain size pool and with a certain amount of gallons of water, and they're very expensive. The motor is the bronze housing for the strainer basket. It's all one packet specifically built by certain manufacturers for large indoor pools.
So are you trying to create a larger balance going forward? So maybe you're bringing to have this thing grow? Is that
it grows.
The fund would grow. Right?
The fund would grow. Since I've started in the beginning of 92, that reserve fund has always been there. I've used it for the new filters that are near now.
What the balance is right now?
5,200.
Correct.
So right now all we have is 5,200.
Right. Yeah, the question that I raise is, how do you determine what comes out of here and what comes out of, say, repair and maintenance? The dollar amount?
For equipment, it would be the dollar amount. Right. If you're replacing,
So you're not going to take, you're not going to fill any little repair items?
No. We wouldn't pay for, a new small parts. It would just be a few.
It's a major repair. The filters came out of this reserve fund. I think we had $35,000.
It was about $35,000.
That's fine. We all know it's an expensive piece of equipment. That's what it's going to be for. Swimming pools are expensive. So.
Actually, though, it doesn't cost.
No.
Overall,
you did a great job with it.
There's not a lot we've spent over there.
Yeah. How's that dryathon thing going? I know we had a problem with that at one point, though.
That's normal. It works fine. I recently put new filters in it yesterday, as a matter of fact. So it's moving air.
Yeah.
And I don't have any complaints.
Okay.
Nobody's complaining about
the
air quality.
Moving it.
I think we should recognize Brad for the fine job he did at Beecher and at this, and at the town hall, replacing all the light fixtures and making more energy to conserve it.
811 fixtures.
Is that right?
Wow.
Must have gotten good at it.
The town's received the check from United Illuminating for this building, and as soon as Beecher sends in their receipts to UI, they will receive two checks, one for North School and one for South School. Brad and Bobby did.
Yeah, it's about, all the Beecher schools, they'll say annually about $18,000 a year in electric. And I think the town hall was $3,200 a year annually. All through electric bill.
Based on like the new rates?
Yeah, on the current rate, the red line. All the fixed rates. It's all gone.
Thank you very much.
Questions? Building maintenance.
It's all you there.
Our retired comrade here. Mr. Allen. So you have a list of the, why don't you just run through them? There's quite a few in the current year. Just give us a rundown. It's the first one we have, I believe, is $8,000 for painting of interior hallways. Is that the first one you have?
Yes, that's here in this building. We're starting to get into, it's not shoddy yet, but it's getting there, and it's a lot easier to paint it now and a lot less expensive. If we do it now as opposed to letting it wait, then it's been requested by several people here in the building that we get after. Then we move on. Your next one should be the interior of the PD. We had those, that and the third item, which also has to do with the PD, and coincidentally for the same amount. Both the painting and the carpet replacement of the PD. The carpet condition over there is getting run down, to say the least, and the gazules emanating from the rugs are getting worse and worse as time goes by. So
we're talking about replacing the carpeting in the police department.
If we're going to do the painting, we thought we ought to do both at the same time. So we consolidated those from 2010 and brought them back into 2009 to do both of those simultaneously, which is really the practical way to do those, as opposed to doing one and making a mess of the other after, because there's no way you can separate the two really without adding to the cost of doing either one.
Where is the carpeting? Is it?
It's in many of the office areas, the training room, the sergeant's room.
Now we always want to put a tile or something.
The roll call room, which is presently carpeted, will be converted to tile.
Is that part of this?
Yeah, that's included here. And the reason for that is that There's some basic arms training that takes place there. Weapons are stripped. Oil gets spilled. The rug in that room is, it really takes a shellacking, and there's just no other place to do it. So that will convert to tile. Now there may be some cleanable mats put in along with the tile, but that's what we propose to do there, and we think that probably be a lot more efficient over the long term. And that's what it is the chief wants. And as you know, the chief, I'm not going to argue with him.
You better. Why not?
Because I'm just,
you
best value of my life. But seriously, it is a practical approach, and we agree with it.
I have a question. This has to do with not just the police department, but the library. We roll a lot of the capital budget items for the library and the police into the building maintenance budget. And the question I have is, eventually we'll have the old firehouse as a budget item. will we roll a lot of the expenses for the old firehouse into this same building maintenance budget?
I would suspect so.
I'm asking, because it's part of the town center, and that would be extra. People have asked me that in terms of maintenance, but whatever we have in the old firehouse as far as use, we're going to roll in this budget, building maintenance.
Building maintenance has been, for some time, Doctor, taking care of the firehouse.
Right.
As a matter of fact, a lot of the maintenance that takes place there comes out.
But I mean, as far as old firehouse, once it becomes a non-firehouse use, whatever.
Long-term, we would just put it into.
Roll that into the old fire, into this building maintenance.
Yes, really, or any of the buildings.
In terms of oil, heating, air conditioning, building maintenance.
Yep. This was created, and we didn't have this always. This was created.
No, I know, it seems like we've done this at least the last 10 years.
Yeah, to try and.
But I just want to see how the old firehouse would roll into this budget.
Absolutely.
Then we go to the repairing of the original bricks of the center building. That essentially, I had an appraisal done by a masonry contractor of the exterior of the center building because of its age. And you can walk around the outside of the building and look at the pointing of the concrete between the bricks. It's worse in certain areas, particularly those that are exposed to the weather. If we grab it now, we can repoint a lot of that and correct it before we start getting water damage and water penetration, and then the inherent ice expansion damage that goes along with that once water starts getting into the bricks, then it really breaks it up pretty fast. And that's something that we think we should do just to preserve the building. Parts of it go back to 1927, and some parts of the old building are really beginning to show their wear. We did have the front steps repointed and corrected this year, and a super job was done there. I would ask that the next time you're in that area to just go look at the front steps to see the job that was done there.
Where?
Contractor by the name of Scuturi did that for us at the center building, the main front steps. And if we hadn't done that this year, there was actually some movement of some of the steps from last winter already as a consequence of water getting in and freezes. And
near the library entrance, on the other side?
No, it's right in the front.
The main front entrance.
I'm sure you'll be impressed with the job that was done there.
So what do they do? They grind out what's in there and then they replace it?
Exactly.
With mortar or whatever?
Yeah, oh yeah.
Would you use the same bag, Jeff?
Obviously, you have to go out for bid. Yeah, I tried to intimidate the finance director.
For 8,800, is this spot pointing? No, spot pointing, or how much are you going to do with bid for $8,800?
The entire outside facade of the building, wherever it needs to be repaired, it'll be done. What he'll do first is to go through the whole building and loosen and scrape out and tear out all of that that's deteriorated. And then when they get all through with that, then they start at the beginning again with new mortar and redo it
all the way across, not just the spots.
All the way across.
And then you had a price, somebody look at it and give you that sort of rough estimate.
Exactly, that was his estimate to do.
And then also last year you had issues with the lentils, I guess, that were separating in that building too.
Yes, that was on the daycare side of the building, and in particularly over the daycare area classrooms. The way the original wall and lintel were constructed, the bricks and the I-beam, the top I-beam, an I-beam is a beam, it has a member this way, a vertical member, and another member down here, if you can imagine that, and the brick sat on the top of that. Well, water would run down the wall and go in underneath, and then this steel started to rust and deteriorate. The rust has an ability, the expansion of the rust has the ability actually to move the brick and loosen the brick. Plus, it was staining walls besides. So what we did, they took out about 6 to 7 quartzes above the lintel. Then we put a stainless steel drip edge. So the bricks now sit on a piece of stainless steel, and the drip edge extends out beyond the steel to cast the water off. And that, so far, has worked very well.
That's all
and we've also stopped the water penetration into those classrooms.
Yes, that's all tight now.
Yeah, that's tight. That came out. That was another one we were happy to get done. It's an old building, and it's, you know, as the years go by, the question that was raised before is how do we arrive at some of these decisions that we make? We don't know. Next year you walk over there and say, oh my God, look at that. You didn't see it the year before, and then all of a sudden you got to come up with $20,000 to fix it. It's a reality. But next. we're catching up with it anyway.
Next.
Okay. Next is, I guess, targeting in the library meeting room.
Question.
Yeah,
how much money is in the library? I think we use it. Can we talk about
good question.
Before we even question it, I've been in that room many times. I don't see the deterioration of this curtain that it's in. I'm not looking at the right spot, but I think everybody should go over there and kind of take a peek anyway before we. Well, wherever it comes from, it doesn't matter where it comes from. I think the first question is it needed? And maybe it is. And if so, then I'm with you. Why is it coming out of that?
I just want to make sure I could do something before you did, Jim. That was my only reason for saying that.
We need to have an idea of when we're going to use, I thought we said when we did what we did that any capital request would come out of that fund. So, you know, again, this was money the taxpayers were supposed to received to offset the cost of the library. It didn't happen because of the way the bond was written. But now, it was my opinion that any capital stuff, when it comes to that, so.
Well, I think it's that we were supposed to recommend it, right?
The building maintenance was just identifying the projects.
Okay.
Right.
Okay, good.
Right. Then when it comes to funding it, the Board of Selectmen and Board of Finance have to determine the funding.
We'll make a recommendation.
That's a different meeting. That's a different meeting.
Right. That's what you go look at.
Well, somebody had it. Who made this determination? The library or you, Joe?
I'm going to recuse myself and suggest that you all speak to the head librarian and she will tell you what her thoughts are on carpet.
Well, Jan, you're on the liaison.
No, we can get some more life out of
it. No, I'm talking about the ceiling tiles. When you take a look at that ceiling, it's sagging all over the place.
Yeah, we did some remediation and replaced some of those tiles. We haven't done them all yet, and those are an expensive pile as they're not like this. They literally fit in our cut all the way around the edge so that they actually drop through slightly the support moldings that they fit in, which makes them considerably more expensive.
Who did that? Okay.
He's going to recuse himself.
Yeah.
Is there a leak that
they,
No,
you're talking about the tiles on the slate roof. That's the old library building. What Sandra's addressing is the tiles in the meeting room
There
are a few that have a little. There's no danger of them dropping out or conking somebody. So we're just waiting until they get a little worse, and maybe the slate roof is the old building. The nails are deteriorating and rusting, and as a consequence of that, we have had some tiles cascade off the roof. It is what it is. We really should. In order to do it properly, the entire slate roof should be stripped and the slate reinstalled and renewed. We can repair it and patch it this year, and then next year we'll be repairing and patching it again.
And that's what you're recommending, Joe, is that?
I would, yeah, as a matter of fact, it might cost us even more than this. I would, if we're gonna do it, ideally, the ideal way to do it is to install slate with copper nails, and that's not the case up there. As a matter of fact, according to the Russo roofing that went up there and examined it, there's a myriad of different kind of nails up there made of different materials. Some are more susceptible to deterioration over the long term than others. And the only way to do it would be to strip that, and fortunately for us, that front section is really not that big. So, professional roofers know how to pull those nails out, take the tiles off, and put them back on again. Then it's done. It'll last us another 50 years or more.
So, do we know what that costs?
We could probably have to double this.
Well, is that what you're recommending we do?
We're waiting for one more contractor to go and look at it for us. One individual who's done a lot of work for the town, who we have a lot of confidence in. We'd like him to look at it. He's already been called, and we thought he would already have been here by now, but hasn't. So I can't be more precise. I don't mean to be vague, but I can't be more precise than that. We do have some good luck. We're hoping the town hall roof heaters, by the way, that is not something that we need to do this year. We would like to do it as we have a flat section of roof over in that side of the building. It's probably, the roof edge is probably about 18 feet.
Joe, there was no warranty on that roof?
What?
The slate roof?
No, that's the old, that's on top of the old library building. I couldn't even hazard guess how old that is, in the 40s? I think that building was built sometime in the
40s. The new roof has a warranty, correct?
The new roof would have a warranty.
And this, $7,000 doesn't get you too far with slate, so.
Exactly. Yeah. The slate will last forever. It's what we're losing the fasteners.
Matter of fact. I guess the question is it worth just replacing it?
Exactly.
That's wasting $7,000.
Get rid of the slate.
Right.
That's
what
Would you get rid of the slate, or do you
know it? That's a question I can't answer because it's the building is considered to be an architectural landmark.
Yeah.
Is it destroyable?
I'm not sure whether we. It wouldn't make any difference to me to get rid of the slate.
They have now synthetic slate. It's sort of synthetic, like a rubber.
That's a question that I think would have to be addressed to Mr. Menzies, but I will get that answer.
It's
easier to install, it's cheaper to install.
Obviously.
That's the copper roof question.
We went through this drill with the restoration of the old firehouse where we had Donald Menzies on the committee, and we preserved those portions of the historical.
There was a good give and take there with that. So for a lot of that with Don and I was impressed with him on that, and we can talk candidly. There's no good relationship with Don, so I'll find out.
What would be the replacement of that site? Are we talking every 10 years, every 20 years?
No, once we strip it and put it back on and renail it, it should stay up there for 50 years.
Well, that's not bad.
Right, what's underneath is good.
Of course, if you took it down, you'd put a new membrane underneath. But that's a very inexpensive part of the roof. That's cheap. It's the labor intensiveness of taking those tiles off and then putting them back on.
So the question is, with the $7,000, is it worth waiting to next year to get the right number? If you get the right number before we complete this budget for this year, because the $7,000 seems to be just.
I'm sticking my neck out to put a number here because I know ultimately we're going to have to face it. And we have a number of options. We can repair it now and get it back under control for this amount of money or less. I'm reluctant to, I would rather spend more and do the damn thing right the first time as opposed to patching it three times for $21,000 if we could take the slate off, remembrane it, and do it for $18,000, I think we'd be a lot better off. So, but I can't give you the answer to that yet, I just can't say.
We'll have it within a couple months.
Oh, yeah.
So we can.
We'll have to wait for, we gotta get on this.
Right?
You'll give that to us when you get.
Right. But I'll also make the inquiry from Don Menzies with respect as to the possibility of our going to a different roof type of material.
What's on the current roof at the new part of the library?
That's the shingle.
The shingles.
Shingle. And part of the roof that you can't see is a rolled roofing membrane, but that's a very shallow sloping roof.
Joe, when you talk slate, just family, having grown up in an 18th century house with a slate roof, the edge flashing became a problem when they were making repairs to the roof.
Right.
And then that tied in to having to replace the gutters. So it was major work. It was a fairly large house. But it was worth every penny if the copper flashing comes down far enough that the gutters aren't destroying it. But may I ask that you investigate the edge flashing and what the relationship of the gutter with the edge flashing is.
We would probably consolidate replacing the gutters at the same time because that's an old roof.
Yeah.
The other thing is, and we went through it here with this building very, very quickly. The gutters, you don't see any gutters on this building. They're built in. They're part of the fascia structure. And that's nice, and a lot of people. I suggested that we just put 6-inch copper gutters around the exterior of this building several years ago. Oh, no, you can't do that. You're gonna ruin the looks of the town hall. Gee, it's gonna look like hell. You see the gutters out. Well, I sat out in the front and looked many, many times at people walking into the town hall, and I've yet to see somebody stop and look. Really, it's an expense, and if we're concerned about taxpayer money, these are things that we need. We're gonna fight about them. We're not always gonna agree. But we're here to do what it is you folks want us to do. We can only give you alternatives. And I think the alternatives ought to be predicated on how much money we're going to have to spend over the long term to do these things. The next item, upgrade to the sprinkler system at the center building, which is out at 2010. That is a $49,000 item, as you see. Which would have required, and I say would have required, that pretty much the entire system be dismantled and put back together again. And the reason for that is that it's impossible to follow the state mandated 3-year wet test, where you actually have to allow the sprinkler system, the dry portion up in the attic, which has compressed air in it, not water. To be actually charged with water to make sure that that it not only holds the water but is operable. We got together with our fire marshal, who got into the code books and did a little research, and we've come to find that as a consequence of the way that system in the center building was initially installed, the kinds of tests that we need to run on it will allow us to get a waiver on that 3-year wet test mandate so that we don't have to put water in. And the reason we don't want to is because it's so damn hard to get it out. It doesn't have the proper kinds of drains in the system to get the water out once you get water in it. If there's a fire, who cares? I mean, we're going to get water and we'll worry about it afterwards. We've come up with an alternative to that. We're having, as a matter of fact, MJ Daly Sprinkler Company going to test our systems the day after tomorrow. What's the name? Thursday. And we'll run our first dry test of that system along with the fire marshal. And if that works, we won't have to spend this money. It's there because if it doesn't work and it's not satisfactory, we don't dare take it out yet. But I might have some good news for you, and I'm leaning 80%, 85% in the optimistic direction that we can probably do without having to do all of that $48,000 worth of work. The other are $49,000. And the other reason we want to get this decided is because we wanted to insulate that attic. We were afraid to do that. We wanted a little bit more heat up there to protect that dry system in the event that some water did get up there, and we did have a freeze problem. You remember what happened here. And we don't want to go through that again. So that's another thing that I'll be able to update you at your next meeting. Or
is this a new thing, Joe, because this wasn't in last year's. Is this a new standard that they...
We got notice that we had to wet test. And when we got that notice, we said, uh-oh, if we put water in there, we're going to have one hell of a time getting out because we have to take half the system apart to drain it.
Okay. I think the rest of these are floor replacement of the Boy Scout rooms down the road.
Well, that's part of adding that room to the police department, and they'll be mentioning that when they come up.
Then we have replaced 4,000 floor rooms at the daycare. Wallpaper and back to library. Wallpaper and paint interior lighting. I think the Board of Selectmen are going to have to decide on projects such as this. Upgrade electrical in the center building, which is about the year 2013. And I guess ADA doors, $15,000 down the road.
That's down the road. As long as nobody comes in and says, you have to do it tomorrow. We'll leave it up.
You're going to still be with us in 2014?
Sure.
I hope so.
I hope so too.
Are we opening that door?
Any other questions for Joe?
You know, you just buy that.
I didn't have that in mind.
Any other questions for Joe on any of these projects?
Thank you, Jeff.
Thanks, Jeff. And now we have the police commission.
Are these vehicles at all are any of them garage?
None of them are garage.
So all of them are for sitting?
On the back of the fire, the back of the police department.
The parking lot.
All of them, I mean, not even any of them.
Everyone.
Everyone.
And that's actually one of our problems, and I really address it.
I was gonna say, my husband has a Ford Explorer, about half those miles, and it's doing really well, but it's in the garage.
Well, last year it was recommended that we get rid of it.
Right.
I couldn't get $1,000 for it. So we elected to keep it, because it is a functional vehicle right now. The SRO and the DARE officer use it to go back and forth to the school, but that's all it's used for, is back and forth to the schools. So the mileage is very limited. In the next year, we're probably not gonna put up on very many miles. But the fact that it does sit a lot is a fact that in the bad weather, it, you know, collects rust, a lot of the brake lines go, they're cost-effective, not cost-effective to replace. Last year, we replaced all four of the wheels on it, the wheels themselves and the tires. Because of the rust on. So that's the one vehicle that we want to replace. And we will, in fact, get rid of it.
Excuse me one minute. When we review the process, are we going to have any garage space, or we're going to get rid of all the garage space?
You'll find it.
Will we get rid of all the garage space?
For what, Jim?
I don't know. I just don't understand why we leave all this stuff out in the middle of a parking lot. It dies quicker.
Especially, not the ones that have to be used all the time, but the ones that are, you're right, if stuff sits, and if stuff sits outside in inclement weather, just like our poor trucks over there, they get beat up.
The police departments normally have garages?
No.
It's pretty typical for them.
They're all police departments.
Oversized.
This is an unusual car that's 11 years old.
No, right?
You're replacing it in a 3-year cycle.
No, I understand. So
she wants to protect all the other vehicles.
And I don't think it's
warranted.
No, that's right by hand, and their cars are always outside.
No, they're used 24/7.
Oranges are always outside.
Everybody's outside.
Everybody's outside. Yeah. I don't know. I was only asking.
Everybody.
Police departments don't really have garages.
No.
But just going on that simple premise, trying to manage the fleet is where we get into this next replacement, asking for two cars next year. We have that old ambulance out there that was donated to us about 10 years ago. It is constantly having to have the brake lines repaired in for the mere fact that it sits for so long. What we want to do is we want to replace the 306, which is a 2005 Ford Crown Vic. Right now it's got 64,000. We anticipate by the end of next year it's probably going to have around 83. Now we're starting to look at it, getting rid of it. What we want to do with that car is we want to replace it with a new Crown Vic, but we want to bring it down and put it into IS in our investigative services. We don't want to get rid of it. We want to do what we've done in the past several years, is where facilities has taken a car, Mary Ellen Rocket has taken a car. We don't want to give away the car this year that's still functional and that can still be used, but we want to utilize it for our ISU, so we're not going to get rid of the vehicle. But at the same time, we are replacing the fleet. We're going to take that car and utilize those, you know, probably got another 20, 30,000 miles on it, good use, and we could probably keep it for another 3 or 4 years. And that's where it would replace our ISU, whereas if you look down to the investigative service in those vehicles, we have a 1996 that's got a 111, and then we got a 1999, it's at 117. Those guys take very good care of the vehicle. I said, but you still have $120,000 or 20,000 mile vehicle over there.
Right.
You know, and it's not that they use it as an emergency vehicle, but a lot of times they go to Fairfield County for meetings, they go, you know, upstate Connecticut for meetings and everything, so they're putting mileages on where, you know, we want it to be a dependable vehicle, a safe vehicle for them.
So are you gonna take two vehicles because they're both?
So we're only getting rid of one vehicle, the Ford Explorer.
Right, because that would take that all out of
it's just,
right.
We're just going to get it. Right. More than likely, we're only going to get $300 or $400 for it. It's not worth it at all.
So what's with the black and white all of a sudden? Where'd that come from?
Tony, did you share the article with them? I actually shared an article. I thought the thing would come up. It's more of a thing that's going on along across the country, that it's a uniformity that the police are trying to put out there. Whereas you get on the road and you don't see a silver vehicle, you don't see a purple vehicle or an orange vehicle. You see a black and white, you know that's a police car. And I actually shared with Tony, I thought it would come up, an article about black and white and why it's becoming a uniform.
The other assumption I learned when I was on the police commission is that a police vehicle every mile of police vehicle, you can save 2 miles on your regular car, because you're stopping and starting.
Yes.
So a 60,000 mile car in a police vehicle is equivalent to my having 120,000 car.
Close, yeah.
Right? I mean, that's something I think everybody should realize. Even though it might be 68,000 or 70,000, it's not being used like my car going to the hospitals.
No.
Or my wife, you know, going to work, or going to the stop, you know, stop and shop. It's a different type of drive.
Plus, they're driven by three different people, so you have different driving habits.
Right. Probably you have more highway mileage on there than
we have. Just
right. It's all stop and go.
Yeah.
So, are you going to buy another Explorer type vehicle?
No.
No. It'll be two Crown Vics. We're going to take that. We're going to get rid of the ambulance as well, because it's just
That's not on there.
It's basically a special response vehicle. We've kept a lot of equipment in and out, but we're just going to put all that equipment, the accident investigation equipment, all the shotguns that we have, any special weapons that we carry, we're all going to go into that vehicle, and it's going to be readily available. It's going to be used, but it won't be used on a regular basis by sergeants. One of those vehicles will be given to the sergeants.
Do one thing for me. 09 to 010 to, what about 011, 012? How many are buying those years? Two a year again?
Well, if we stay with two cars this coming up this year, being able to manage the fleet, I originally had asked for three cars in 2011. I said, I just cut it out. We'll stay with two cars each year.
So it's basically two cars each year until 14?
Correct.
Yes. And the plan is, it'll be black and whites going forward, so we'll maintain that uniformity going forward.
Yes.
We're
all going to be, all black and whites.
And the difference in that $2,000 or $3,000 it was $2,000 from 50 to 48, was we had to go into some new equipment, we had to put some new light bars on them. And that's a cost issue too. I mean, you know, you're talking about, we're going from, you know, the regular old standard bulb lights to LEDs.
So the honest question the public's going to have is, why would we not want another Expedition or another Explorer in the future?
We don't feel that we really need it right now.
Okay, because at some point you did, and now we've decided that we don't.
But we haven't.
Oh, I understand.
That was the only
before. But
that's going to run out someday, right? You don't have anything in this budget to replace that.
No, but the chief and I have discussed, when he gets into his vehicle that following year, his vehicle might be an all-wheel drive vehicle, so we're actually putting another into the fleet. The consensus of the sergeants right now.
No.
That's not in the budget.
No.
I mean, just so you know, the consensus of this, of our five sergeants that we have, is that when they go on a patrol, they patrol in that Expedition. And a lot of times they're asked to actually have a patrol, because there's only the minimum manpower of two, and that minimum manpower could be a sergeant patrolling.
Well, you understand what I'm saying.
Yeah. Well,
at one point we asked for an Explorer, an Expedition, and now there's nothing for the next 7 years that requests an Explorer and Expedition. Correct?
How long will this one last? How long will this
last? Well, that's what we're trying to do. I had explained that we're trying to lengthen the use of the Expedition without having to do pick and place.
But that car might not last 5 years, correct?
Yeah. Well, if we don't do it, they take very good care of it.
Okay.
It'll last 5 years.
It's only got 53,000 on it.
So you're going to have it, that's why it's not, the answer to my question is it's not in the budget, it's going to last for
yes.
5 years.
Oh,
yes.
Absolutely.
Okay, fair enough.
And that's the one reason we're taking it out of that regular use.
That's all I'm asking. So,
it will last.
So at some point in the next 3 years, we're going to see that on the budget in FY15 or 16, something like that.
Yes.
Okay.
It's amazing, surprising that Ford, obviously the Crown Victoria is
they're terrible cars.
But it's the vehicle of choice.
They're terrible cars in the winter.
Well, I'm saying it's amazing. I mean, more and more and more cars are coming out of all-wheel drive. You think they, in as much as
a lot of departments are going to other cars,
yeah.
Chargers, Ford Taurus.
This is rear-wheel drive, right?
Yes.
Crown Vic's not even front-wheel drive. Mm-hmm.
Ford tried to do it with the vehicle that I have, the one that you allowed me to buy last year. I said, but it didn't fly. And Ford even is still trying to do it with the Taurus. They brought it back on the same frame as the 500, and they're calling it the Taurus right now. It's an all-wheel drive vehicle. The chief over in Orange just bought one.
They'd be all-wheel drive.
The Crown
absolutely
is
terrible. They really are.
It's terrible.
In the Northeast, they are.
Yeah. So why do you buy it?
That's the police package.
Because that's the police package.
It's the best police car out there.
Okay.
As far as, you know, we
think. Yeah, if it doesn't snow. Or rain. Or you can leave it on the ground.
Again, we mentioned other cars being brought into fleets elsewhere, like Dodges, for example. Any experience on that?
No, I don't have it.
You know, Bridgeport has Chevrolets.
Bridgeport went all to
I thought they were the Chargers.
60 Chargers.
Yeah, okay. Dodge Chargers.
But then,
yeah. Now, I don't know if they're front wheel, all wheel. I don't know.
I mean, we're just trying to go to black and white. It's probably going to take us 3 to 5 years to go all black and white. If we decided we wanted to start driving Chargers, we would buy two this year, and then we would be funding two different types of vehicles.
I'll make it that by F12, you're going to have a all-wheel hybrid.
I agree.
Yeah.
They got it. Like I said, I remember a time Mercedes said they would never do an all-wheel drive because it would ruin the ride.
I'm not talking about all-wheel. Guess what? All-wheel hybrid. I think you're going to see a hybrid all-wheel drive in the next 3 or 4 years.
Yeah. It stands to reason for.
Well, does it matter if they're different cars as long as they're black? I mean, if you thought that they were better cars,
well, they're
safe.
Tires, different length bars,
so
different equipment for inside the vehicles. You know, they're not the same size as a Crown Vic.
So why don't you purchase another all-wheel vehicle then?
We're not ready yet.
You're not ready?
No.
No, it's, first of all, it's not big enough for a police vehicle.
Oh, okay. It's not
no.
I mean, if we go into a 500, we'd be in a heck of a thing because they discontinued it.
So what you're saying?
We decided to put that into our fleet. I mean, this is the best standard police car out in the field right today. Everything an officer wants.
It's like big inside.
Everything
is just like that car. We still work.
And we look at this every year. So I mean, there's something better comes up.
Chevy's in the market. I mean, Chrysler's in the market. Everybody's in the market.
You just
don't Ford
stop looking at new things, even
choice.
If it's different. I think as long as
it's still the best one, unfortunately, it's just terrible in some.
Okay. And I also share with Ponius, if anybody had any reason about it, was the ethanol issue. I mean, it's just Ford does supply a vehicle that's, they call it an E85, it's an ethanol. But we don't even want to look at that unless the town decided to go to ethanol vehicles. It's just, there's no cost savings, there's no gas savings, and that's what the article says. It's just, unless you go to the whole fleet, it's not even an issue. There's not a significant shift. There's no savings in gas mileage or anything like that by going to it. All it is that if the town went to ethanol is cheaper. That's all it is.
There's no savings in cost. It's better for the environment, but there's no savings in
cost. Oh, yeah, that too.
Isn't there some saving because these are fleet purchases and we get the benefit?
What around state bid?
State bid.
Yes.
But it's the state bid. I'm saying is if you wanted to just go out and buy an E85, it's Crown Vic. It's a standard vehicle. It'll burn either ethanol or regular gas. And there's no change in anything over anything like that. And that's what the article explains. But what the article does tell you is that there's no savings to you by doing that. There's no savings in gas mileage. There's no savings in especially the ethanol. Unless you can get it and all your fleet is ethanol, it's immaterial.
Okay, why don't we move on to the second item? It's probably the general discussion. It's a $91,000 total request over the 6 years. Why don't you just run through this computers, lane, cabin, that's it.
Computers. Do they have Brian's request to me?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That page, Brian Freeman, our computer specialist. And I have to say, we rely on him greatly. If I didn't have him, I wouldn't be able to put a presentation.
So what was your work on? You made the notes on the side.
Pardon? Those are my notes, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Everybody has those.
Yeah.
So Brian said that we need the two workstations. Basically, the two new workstations are Sergeant Frank Capiello, who's our administrative sergeant who runs the Detective Bureau, who also does all the, you know, permits, firearm permits, everything that's sent out of the department, as well as quality control for the dispatchers that they do all our academy for the department. It would be replacing of his computer as well as our booking computer, which is one of the older ones. And that's what we do all our booking, obviously, and that's got to be up this month. But what you have to understand is that these two computers are not going to be the ones that are going to be replaced. We would start from the top. And I think you have over the past couple of years, you've gotten a workstation configuration. And on the right, there's a legend. And if you understand computers and you understand, you know, Pentiums and everything like that, the most critical areas are where we replace the computer with a brand new one. We just replaced two brand new ones, we replaced them in our dispatch area. Those two dispatch computers that were basically the best ones we had then would be they would just be rotated down to the next most area where we felt they were necessary, and that's how they were replaced. But those were the two. I figure we should stay with two. Mobile data terminals. These are the terminals that Panasonic cufflinks that go in the police cars that the officers use. He wanted to replace four of them. He felt that it was necessary to replace four. You know, we talked about it and everything, and we've done some configuring over there, and we're only asking for two instead of four. I think we can get by. Just this past year with Homeland Security money, I actually was able to purchase a laptop, which actually helped out the department on the desktop side, because I have a laptop that works both in my car as well as at my desk, so I don't have a desktop at my desk. And that's shown up on the configuration. We've done some things like that, so we're only asking for two. So that's $7,000. We need to replace an additional, getting an additional vehicle, we have to replace an additional laptop to go into that, or a computer system. And to do that, it's $8,500. That's the cost of the Panasonic laptop, the docking station, the associated equipment, and the motor needed. I feel that we're able to real deal. We'll be able to offset at least half of that price. So that's how we came to the request for 13.4. The 23.5 for the separate capital request for the next gen mobile upgrade is on a whole different capital request for 2010.
You're actually gonna have one full additional patrol car though in the field that you have currently. That.
Correct.
Decked out, ready to go.
Correct.
You feel that you need that?
Yes. Correct.
Covering your staff, I guess, you know.
Any questions?
I'm sorry. What's that 31.5 in the following year? In the 2010, we're going from 1340. Now we're going to 30.
The 31.5 for next year is that, and I was in anticipation of our servers. Our servers are going on, they'll be going on close to almost seven years. If you remember, if you weren't aboard that time, we actually bought those servers with a justice grant that we offset the capital budget back at that time. But that's what that reflects. That reflects four servers. That will be needed to be replaced. And then we just go back into our budget.
Are these coming out state bid too?
Excuse me?
Are these state bid, or these are just you go out and how do you pick
these? Well, the cars are on state bids, the laptop computers are on state bids. Most of the things that we...
How about the desktops?
Now, we get those from Dell. We've had a really good service plan with Dell.
There is a state bid for desktops, but sometimes it's because the market changes so quickly, it's not often the best price.
Okay.
Yeah. So. And Brian shops around for the best
price. Yeah, we use it as a benchmark, and then we shop around a lot of times.
And Brian's very good.
Just the other day, it's cheaper.
Because we get our service plan and everything through Dell, they're just excellent. And next day delivery and everything.
Nobody too well.
Okay, what's this story
that mobile data?
No, let's talk about this building security. What is this one talking about? Because now, when you walk into the police department now, you have to get buzzed in by somebody to tell us, right?
And we have keys for all the other doors. And we have the chief and I have a master key that we can get into a good portion of. But what we're trying to do is we're trying to upgrade security. So it's access control. So we know who comes in the building, when, and where they're going in the building.
We're going to do this for all our buildings.
Exactly.
This for the town hall. We're going to do it for the fire department.
We're looking to, we received a grant on the town side, and this would be the funding for the police, and we're looking to join with the new fire station as an alternate on the bid process to try to come up with a cohesive sort of plan.
Why would it's a card system.
Why would this
card
system. Why would this be on a building maintenance budget?
Well, if you're going to do it for the whole town, it should probably be in one place.
That's what I'm asking.
Yeah, and you're right.
You could put it there.
You could.
Yeah. Well, we're doing their carpet. We're doing a couple other things. terms of tiles.
This is something new, though, isn't it?
This is more of a...
But we're doing it for the whole town. Why would it be on their budget?
I don't think this would be building maintenance. It's a whole new entry system.
Well, this portion of it wasn't necessarily on the town.
I think we want to have the police department in control of the entire security for all our buildings. So that's the idea.
I mean, it started with last year's request, which was both building and our visual security that we in fact put in.
So Sandy just said to me, we're funding to be a different situation when we get to that situation. So it doesn't really matter to discuss that, right?
But we're going to look at it in camp in total.
So how would this change the current system of walking into the police department?
It's for our officers.
Okay, this is...
We'll not have to use a key anymore. They just continually snap off in the lock.
I mean, it's just...
It's just old.
Were you using a fob?
Yes, similar.
The only other additional question on that line, I mean, if they're going to do it for the police department, we're going to do it for town hall, are there any cost savings and do it for all?
That's what we're trying to do.
But that's what we're looking into.
We're trying to do that.
Our exception is that the town is looking at what the fire department is going along.
And the town center.
And then it'll be administered by...
And where we fund it, that'll be determined later. Doesn't matter whether it's in their budget or the building.
Right.
We can do that later.
This will allow you, it basically documents who enters...
No, I understand what it'll do, but I'm just saying how we...
It's a good system.
Right, and the final item in 2010 is a mobile data upgrade.
It's all right. It's a big problem.
It's going to be scattered like the oil budget.
Nah, we're going to put it together.
The mobile data upgrade, right now, we deal with a company called Next Generation Solutions. They do our whole CAD system, our land system for our funds. They're one of probably three or four companies within the state. The state just went exclusively with them last year for their whole computer system. With that, the chief had received a letter last year from NextGen offering us to... The mobile upgrade would be so the officers can in fact do all their work out in the police car. All that work that they do out in the police car can be electronically sent to the police station. Right now, what they have to do, if they have to do an action report, they have to come into the building because they don't have the capabilities of doing that in the car, on a computer. What this system does is it allows them to do it out in the car. It gives them a lot more versatility out in the car as far as mapping, doing accident reports. Like, Matt, if you had an accident, down at the corner here, and they had to map it out and everything like that, they bring it right up on the computer. They get all the figures. You get everything, and it's right there in front of them.
Bottom line, they're forcing us to do it. That's the bottom line.
I put it in 2010 because sometime, sometime within the next two to three years,
everybody's going to have to go. Who has?
NextGen won't support their system that we have personally now. We'll have to go.
We have to do it.
Basically, it's just letting you know that it's a big cost. Last year it was 23. This year it's in the area of 20.
Maybe it'll
come down a little bit
more.
But it is a substantial cost, and it's something that more than likely in the next 2 or 3 years
we're going to have to get.
It just seems odd that. I hear what you're saying. It just seems to be, isn't it? You come to the police department, type this thing up, and sit in the car with the steering wheel in the belly, and
they still do it. It's, but we're gonna have to get it.
No, I know you're gonna have to get it, but why couldn't it be?
It's about efficiency. It's about keeping the officer. You might think that the officer could come into the building and do that. But I says, well, when the officer's in the building, spending 2 hours doing all his paperwork here in the building, he's not on the road. So, a lot of people are complaining, where's the police officer?
On an accident report, when you have to draw the little car, they make little squares. You have to do all this? You're still not doing the manual.
Does everything.
Does everything.
Yeah, because I mean, you still kind of hand write these things, right? These accident reports?
It's an upgrade of the GPS system where it will, in fact, if an officer says, I have to go to, such and such an address, the computer will basically tell them how to get there.
Next great invention for
technology.
This is actually a computer system that's drilling into your central office.
It's more software.
How is it transmitted from the vehicle to the station?
Over an IP address. And basically what this
wireless?
Yeah, this whole system is guarantees the security too as well. I mean, that's one of the big factors in it's the net solution where they guarantee that that confidential information that you're going to be sending is going to be sent.
Can you just shake my brain a little bit? How do we get tied into NextGen? What's the history of that? Is that the whole state has NextGen or just certain?
Well, not the whole state, but it's just our computer system that we have.
How long will we have next year?
8 years.
Eight years.
So we're really tied into them because of the history?
Yes. They have a good product.
No.
They really do.
They have a good product. There's other companies we could go for out there, it's just, but then we'd have to change our whole operating system.
All the laptops.
Laptops, recorders,
everything.
Our CAD system, the whole thing.
Okay.
And there's some cost savings when we go to this, where we're running the captain system right now. It's a system where we have, it's like, you know, the intercommunications that we have between, you know, this town and other towns on the computer. We won't have to pay for that anymore because we won't.
It'll be incorporated with next year.
So there's a wash, but it's on the plus side for us. So it is a good thing.
This uses the repeaters all through the town. Is that how it works? You say it uses an IP address, but how does it access it?
Through phone lines.
Through phone lines.
Yeah, I believe that's what it is right now.
How could it be phone lines if they're in the car? Wireless? Is it?
Well, yeah, it's just like, well, right now we use singular. I think if we went to the next gen, the new mobile, I think it's Verizon. Like I said, I technically wise, I really can't answer your question
in regards to that.
The captain system right now, all the wireless information that's sent right now, is done through singular.
Okay, any other questions for?
And how about the reception? Do you have any problems with the reception?
No, we don't have any problems in town. You mean radio reception?
No, with the.
Computers?
No, with the computers right now.
With singular.
There may be a dead spot here and there, but no, for the most part, we're okay with those.
Like any other computer that you might have.
Like a cell phone.
Okay, anything else?
Only just before the end of the previous presentation, you had mentioned about. Do you have any questions?
Well, Sandy.
Yeah, I wanted to just have you explain the renovations that you were proposing in your home. That's what you wanted to do. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, we felt it was necessary when we gave the presentation that back in 2001, obviously they took building maintenance out of the police department's budget. We saw, you know, a little bit of a decline in we wanted had to go through facilities, and we also saw that, you know, in the past several years, as Joe indicated earlier, that, you know, it's extending from year to year as far as, you know, and specifically the carpet as well as the painting in the building. In my report, over the last 15 years, we've done a lot of some nice renovations. Previous chief did, you know, a lot of work in the building and everything, but unfortunately, it didn't give us any space. It just gave us more working area, utilizing that same space. We'll make sense of it. What we need is actual space. Facilities is doing a fantastic job. I can't commend them any more than they're just doing a great job over there, giving us the space. They gave us another office last year. Tomorrow we're going to be working on our investigative service unit. They're going to be putting in a one-way mirror that we actually had. That they're going to be putting in our interrogation room, but again, it's all about space and
we're getting bigger, but the department's getting smaller. The building is getting smaller for us, basically. I mean, I go over there just to see some of this. I mean, we have how much do we have computer in the back room? The other voice got room.
Oh, a $600,000 radio system that we have that access to the other part of the building. It's easier for them to access that $600,000 radio system, which is both fire and police, than we do. The other day, I walked in the back and the back door was open. The door to the police department is locked, but the back door to our $600,000 radio system, is wide open. Nobody around. And apparently somebody had left that portion of the building and calling out that door. It's and the reason they have easier access is it's fire access. By fire code, we can't secure that door. We can't secure that door or the door that adjacent the other portion of the center building. I mean, we're not looking to kick anybody out. I'm not about to mention any people that are in there right now. But that's the logical space that would be available.
What space?
Voice tower.
Voice tower.
Well, you know, it's interesting because listen to a lot of the talk about the old firehouse uses. I'm also hearing a lot of scuttlebutt rumors about the center buildings. And that is, I'm sure, too. If this moves here, this moves here, that moves there. And I think...
Ed and I spoke about, you know, right, maybe getting some of the firehouse, the old firehouse when it's renovated.
Or,
you know,
let's say the fitness room moves out. So there's a lot. So I think when we determine what we want to use the old firehouse for,
exactly,
the priorities,
we talk about that.
And I think that will come to pass, that will not only address the old firehouse, but I think we're going to have to address the center building uses, because there may be some vacancies there.
Right.
The fitness room, we've heard talk about the feature movie. I mean, all sorts of things.
We're having those ongoing discussions.
Right.
Now.
And I think that we'll have to, the board of selectmen will look at that too.
That's
keep
fine.
In mind the police department's needs as well.
Yeah, we're just really overcrowded.
But I think we're gonna have to look at all whole center, not just the firehouse, because some of the stuff in the firehouse may come from the center. Some of the stuff in the center may move elsewhere. It's a puzzle. It's a puzzle.
Okay.
But you won't be forgotten.
A very patient.
As long as you don't ask for a new fire, a new police station.
That's what we don't want to get to. We want to get to that.
Just want to
the library.
Okay. Any other questions for Chief and Deputy Chief?
Thank you.
Hey, Bert.
Thank you.
You have a shot.
Here.
You have a shot.
Here.
Adam, you're
next. Do you really? Oh, boy. What do you? I got to go.
Recreation, front and center.
Sorry. Had to go and get some food. It's cold now.
Well, I only had one request for 09, which is the utility vehicle replacement.
Pushed that out to 010. Yeah, I pushed it back to 010. We just, I was going to explain it to you.
So there's nothing wrong?
No, no, because Brad fixed the car. It cost a little bit of money, but we pitched past again for another year. So instead of staying 10,000, push it back a year, we'll get maybe another year out of the car, hopefully we'll get it. If not, Joe Hellar said he'll drive us around.
What are they, Mercedes?
We all heard that.
So we pushed it back, so I'd like to push that back to 010, because we'll have the car for one more year.
What did you do? Because your explanation sounds ominous here about the condition of that.
Right.
You know, exactly. Safe condition.
That's quite.
What did you do? How do you solve metal fatigue?
Epoxy glue.
Right.
He actually,
wire mesh.
He put a new motor. He put a whole new motor system into it. Put a whole new motor. Put a brake system. Put up a guard on the front side. Fixed the back of the truck. Fixed the fender. Fixed the front fender. Wheel welded everything like this. And we have a rope across the side that's tied in.
What is this?
It's like a big golf cart.
It's a big golf cart.
It's a big golf cart.
You can't stop it.
We actually had it there long enough. We had to wait so long for the motor that he just said, well, let me just pitch. So every time we have a few seconds, we do a little something to it. You know, Brad, once he takes something apart, it doesn't go back together again unless it's perfect.
When are you going to get to replace it for $10,000?
Well, I wanted to get a bigger one. I wanted to get one with, that we put all the equipment on instead of having make two.
What brand are you talking about?
Oh, John Deere. We were looking at John Deere. We were looking at a couple of them.
You can get one for $10,000.
Can you get one for him, too?
We did. Cheap.
Well,
that's what he wants.
That's why I'm asking.
Well, what we do is we take
a... I was thinking Kubota, a Rhino. I mean,
$10,000. When I went for the tractor for the town, when the rec department...
You talking about used wheels?
No, we're talking about a new one, but year old. You know, sometimes you have the ones that the 2007 model, the end of the year model that doesn't sell from last year, but they have it like this, and they don't. You know, everybody wants to buy a new one.
I'll call you.
We'll take a brand new one from the year past.
I want one for $10,000. That's great.
Well, I bought the tractor for the town. Looking like this, everybody wanted $25,000, $26,000 with this piece, that piece, and 2 or 3 pieces. I finally found a John Deere dealer in Shelburne. I was talking to him, and he said to me, "You know, well, I can get it to you for $15,000. I can get you this and that and that. Well, can you wait 6 months? I'm going to go to Christmas time to my brother's in Maine. He has a John Deere dealership. I'll pick this up. He has one store from last year. I'll put it in my truck when I come home." You know,
you're the best.
And that's how you get it. And then you're old, and it's brand new.
That's great.
Now, where does this thing get stored? At Beecher?
Beecher School. We have the underside garage underneath by the pool that goes in there. That's the only piece of equipment that can fit in there when there's the ladders, because they put in the new oil tank.
What do you use this for?
Movement of all our equipment, recreational equipment. In the summertime, when we have summer camp, we have maybe 100 cones that have to go out. We have all the signs that have to go out. That's what I mentioned early. The guys come in early, about 7 o'clock before camp even start. They've got it already set up, set it before camp, take it down. Any piece of equipment has to move to any field we move. Our weekday programs, we fill the car with all our equipment for the kids for flag football or soccer or anything like that. We fill it up.
Trans bathrooms.
I was going to say, how about your entertainment equipment? Yeah. It comes in the back.
Pizza man.
Pizza man. Yeah, I haven't seen them do it. Tag sale man. Then I figured something might stop for real.
That's right.
Okay, next is, why don't you just give us a rundown on the tennis courts.
Okay, the tennis courts, again, there's another one I want to do. I'm going to take the 2010, move that out a year to 2011, because the tennis courts were just fixed. We just had Joe secured a company like this. They came in, they did a nice job, they pitched, patched, they cut open the cracks that were in the thing, they put it apart, they put down some sealant like this. I looked at it and I said, it looked like fiberglass patch going through the whole thing like this. I'm looking at it going, this is not going to work. And then they painted it black, so I got nervous and called, I said, that's the wrong color. They said, no, that's called the undercoating. A little nervous. And then they painted the whole thing blue with stripes, and it came out gorgeous. The only problem we had was between the asphalt and the ground, there was no barrier to stop, I guess, the moisture coming through. So the paint kind of bubbled a little bit. If you stood back, the court was perfect. But if you walk up onto the court and get real close, you'll see the bubbles like they did at the tennis center, you know, down at Yale. So he said that it would dry, I guess, once the sun comes out.
We paid him 90% of the contract. He withheld 10%. And he has a letter to Mr. Genovese and myself indicating that he would make good on everything. He wants to do a lot more business for both the town, plus he does a lot of private tennis facilities to citizens here. And so I had Carquist and Mark Armstrong with me. We looked at it. I think the land's reasonable, and I think that's a good deal. The exterior, these things look like they've got measles. If you're 100 feet back, it's a gorgeous looking facility. And if you can think of what it looked like for the last 25 or 30 years.
Oh, yeah. It was a fabulous job for what we paid. They did a great job. It's perfect. And then Adam will fix the post, and we'll get the tennis and the tennis nets up. We have some of the facilities.
On the spring, it's going to be gorgeous. So.
Yeah.
So what do you anticipate doing in addition? You're going to move the 15 to 11. The other 15, how are you doing this?
Well, this is going to be a fun. The story of this one like this, because you know down the road, the court's going to have to be remodeled. I mean, this is just a patch job. But if it comes apart again like this, I think we should have a fund, just like we had the fund for the filter at Beecher Pool that time. We put away.
So you're moving all three of these off again?
Yeah, move all three back. All three back.
Okay. How about the...
I put in
the skate park.
Yeah, I put this in.
We were talking about this last
day. Yeah, I know we did. This is my protest to them. I think somewhere down the road, you know, they got to look at this, and I know that the town has to be self-insured to do something like this, but it's something that there's a need and the kids really like and really do. And if you go take a ride out to Cheshire, and Cheshire High School, and go across the street from Cheshire High School, where they just had the National Monument brought in for the Vietnam, right there's a beautiful, beautiful park. It has a 10-foot-high fence around the entire park. The park is open, and they have an attendant. The attendant stands here. You don't enter the park without a helmet, elbow pads, knee pads, wrist pads. If you have that, you're allowed to come in. If you don't, you can't use it. And the place is always packed with kids. Every time I go there, I always stop just to see them. I umpire a lot of softball games and some baseball games on that side of the field. And you get to see them. Also, if you go there sometime, you see cricket. I never saw cricket before in Connecticut. But they play cricket on that side of the field over there. So It's just something I wanted to put into the budget, just to see down the road, maybe we can, you know, we can find a facility, secure it with a high fencing, you lock it, you only open it, you know, when you have an attendant on duty. And we can do it, open something like that.
We have a private skate park opposite the district animal control center, there's a skate park. And in fact, David, I think you and I were on the planning and zoning commission when that application came in about 2 years ago.
That's right.
And it's operational.
And the fencing facility?
Right next to, right behind it, keep going past it, used to be karate center where they kept all their trucks.
Oh, the garage there.
The garage now skate.
Skate park?
Really?
That garage is, yeah.
Inside the open road?
Did that actually get done?
It is done.
I wouldn't want their heat. Wow, nobody knew that, it's amazing. There's a secret park, right.
Well, you got some pretty cool city tonight.
I guess they need a marketing person, but.
Yeah, right here.
I only know that because it came across us from planning and zoning some years ago.
I'll have to take a look at it, see what it is.
It's just not that much publicity.
No.
Because I know, Stan, you're big into this, right? You have your own skate park.
He's out there every day.
You and Rita do a lot, I see you not often.
Every day he pays, I have behind fans.
See him tonight, I'm dancing with the stars.
Well, I'm going to have to take a look, but I just think it's something that as a community, it may be something that we need to, you know, secure for the younger midterm adult junior high school students that really like the skateboard and want to go out there and do. That might be a private organization that has that one, but I'm going to take a look and see if it meets the needs of what other folks might have. But the next one I have is the Board of Licensing we put out in 2012. I put it out there. I talked with Adam. Adam and I had a long talk. We looked at this. A lot of them were failed. They failed around. I went through one in Cheshire that they had, and it had broken on one side. I went to one in Orange. I had a meeting at the Orange Center, and I went out there to take a look at theirs, and they had a problem on one side where, you know, the kids come in, they with their skate, and they cut it. It has to be protected like that. I think we have an excellent facility over here, over at the Sparrow property, but we need to just work on. I know it's tilted a little bit on the side, and it gets like 6 or 8 inches at one side and maybe an inch at the other end. If we can just put a little curbing on one side, raise one side up to about 10, 12 inches, so the other side is at 2 or 3 inches, but if we could seal the cracks, there's 3 or 4 big cracks that go through, we could just seal the cracks, so that even if it melts, the water stays there. Our problem is when it melts, water goes through the cracks, sinks in like this, we lose it. I have to ask the fire department again to come over and help me. I have to get somebody over there. By the time you put the water back out there, the ice that's there floats. The water goes under the ice, floats it up. I guess you get a double mix. So if we can get something that can just hold the water, even if it melts, the water would stay right there. You know, so maybe we can work on something like that. But down the road, I put it out a few years because technology always changes. You know, come up with something, a better type of material that can lay down on the bottom so that you won't lose the water. I put out there just to see down the road if there's something.
We also thought it'd be a good idea to somehow paint it white so it had a reflective surface rather than a heat absorbing surface from the sun. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay.
That would
help a lot. Should have said too while we're at it.
Yeah. In 2013, I placed the 90-foot diamond complex. I know that the town is looking at different properties like this, and the money was secured years ago, but I just put it out there so that once we have a position, once we're ready to go, that it's in our budget and then we can have something to do with it. We can build our own 90-foot diamond for the first time. It's something that I think is desperately needed to expand the Father's League. The Father's League only goes up to a certain age, and then they have to disband and they go into those travel teams. I think if we had this, we had another 90-foot diamond, we would be able to move up and keep more students. Because, you know, the Father's League started only with 100, 150 children. They're up over 600. They're really up there. Same thing with like, the soccer league. The soccer league extended even faster. They started with like 100, 200, and now they're up to over 450. So their programs are expanded. So the fields are really being used. You know, we took a look at the Allegheny property the other day, where the carnival is. We looked at that and like this, and if we turn that down and take a look at that, we might be able to put two real nice practice fields right in there with hardly any work at all. We brought in the excavator, we're just looking at it, and he said to me, if you put in two tiered fields, you wouldn't have to move hardly anything at all. Lay it in, and within a year or so, you'd have two more practice fields. And I think it was two areas, and a nice smooth area, like if the carnival is going to be held there, that they would have a nice smooth area to have that their carnival on at the same time. So it's just an expandable piece of property. Do that. And then the last one is the treadmill. This will be the last in the series of removing our treadmills. Every 5 or 6 years, a treadmill that's used commercially is used so much by so many different people, so many different ways, and it appears down. And Rob works for us over at, Rob Kenyon works for us at the rec office there at the fitness center. Does a fabulous job of moving it. He was talking to one of the guys from the company. We wanted to buy a new, what they call a base bed that the treadmill goes on. And Rob said, well, how about if we just turn it over? And the guy goes, well, that's the $1 million secret. Nobody knows, you just flip it over to the other side and you have a brand new board. They always want to sell you a new one. So he was able to do that. And then when he called to order a board that we needed, the guy said, well, only have two left. Rob said, we'll take both. And sure enough, we took both and put one away. We used one, and a year later, we needed another board. We had it, and you couldn't order it. So we just ordered a treadmill from the last one. It's just when PO was passed through and everything like this. It should be coming in November. And we'll take the one we have now that Rob fixed, and it's still working beautifully. We'll put that in the closet. We'll have it as a backup. We'll always have a backup. So if one goes down and it has to be fixed, we just wheel it out, wheel the other one in, and then we can work on it at our own pace and don't have to worry about, you know, having it down and having the patrons sitting around saying, well, we need a treadmill because the weight center is doing it. It's nice. Also, into the beautiful, nice area for the weight room would be beautiful. You have a nice, big, long space, about 6.5 inch. Jim's not looking at me. Cement area, nice, big, long, beautiful, vulnerable.
Is there anything like that available?
There might be something in one of the buildings around the town that might become available soon. Just thought we'd mention that. And that's basically our presentation for the capital budget. You know, we're streamlined, but we just ask for what we need and what it looks like that the town could use.
Any questions for John or Stan?
I remember a couple of years ago you mentioned a fishing pond. Is that still an idea on the table?
Well, that's something that we could do. Yeah, that's
we haven't talked about it.
We haven't talked at it, but I use Amity Pond all the time. It's a nice pond to go over there for practice fly fishing, mm-hmm. like this, and there are some fish in there. But on the Fitzgerald property, there's a pond in the back. If that someday maybe we can look at that and take an access to that, you know, once the fire house is built in the areas like this, maybe there's an access that we can use the town residents. You know, I don't know what you can do environmentally, but if you can dig that out and get an access to that pond, that was a nice pond a long, long time ago. Mm-hmm. That we used to, you know, sneak over on our bikes, park, and go back there. It was hard to get back there, but once you got back there, you know, spent most of the time getting your line on the trees.
Yeah.
But that's an access that we can do because the state has a lot of programs for fishing.
Correct, right. And that would be a nice recreational, kind of outside community kind of activity also.
When it became by recreation this summer, we saw Fishing Man. Fishing Man had about 12, 15 poles out there. Those were all recreation that we got from, who was that, he was the warden for the state of Connecticut like this, and he told us about a fishing program, so we held it at Amity Pond. And Mr. Brennan.
Oh.
Mr. Brennan. Uh-huh. And he got us, they came in and we had gotten some rods, everybody brought their own rods, and then also he came with a box of rods. These are from the state of Connecticut. So there are programs out there that if you offer, you know, they give you a program like this. Like the tennis program came in one time, we had the tennis program a few years ago, and they brought in, they gave us a dozen rackets, you know, and they gave us a box of balls. Of course, the box of balls were probably used about 280 times, but at least they had something that was round to hit around the kids.
But nobody really stocks the Amity Pond.
No, Amity Pond is just what's in there. It's just what's in the pond. You know, but there are a few fish in there. Are some fish
alligators.
But I believe back then when Mr. Brennan did it, the state came up. I think they threw about 50 to 60 trout within the pond. They weren't holdover trout because they weren't going to hold in that pond.
Yeah.
Well, they had an event there that day, right? Where they sponsored some kind of an event.
Yeah, it was fishing derby. Yeah, fishing derby. They have a fishing derby in ours. They have it in ours in different ponds like that. But if you have an area like that and want to fish, you can do it. Yeah. Those are a lot of fun for kids.
Okay.
Thanks.
Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you, gentlemen. I'll put that right in. It's a nice park to drive into it.
Our final presentation of the night is Public Works.
Could I ask one question?
Sure.
Is Michael Luther okay? Because he didn't say anything.
He's anticipating dancing with the stars. He's kind of not thinking about what's going on today. Okay, public works. I guess, Ward, most of what you've got here are continuing projects, funding projects that we've had in the past, reserves, et cetera. You want to just run through the mechanics of this?
Sure.
Starting, I guess, with what first was equipment replacement reserve?
Okay, equipment replacement, pretty much that's staying consistent from what we said in the past. The one major change is the fact that we took out the asphalt paver and basically are building reserve for the backhoe replacement.
Do we have much in this reserve at this point?
Yeah, and to break down these issues,
we're going to get a backhoe for $40,000.
See, he wants one of those too.
These guys are getting good toys for really cheap. I'm really jealous.
We've got $73,010 in reserve.
So what is the imminent replacement for the next year or so? What are you going to do?
The closest thing in the reserve is a replacement sweeper.
Okay.
We have the old antiquated tricycle type sweeper. It's an 88. It's the biggest detriment with that is parts replacement slowly becoming non-existent, and just the maintenance upkeep of the machine. The sweeper that's proposed in this is, I don't want to say the latest and greatest, but it is something that is it's more suitable to the town's needs. It's something that will follow what we the contract sweepers that come to town use, as opposed to something that's met more for parking lot needs. With that, we can eliminate the contract sweeping and do that ourselves and save on the operating budget by us doing that work.
How much would you say?
Right now, the contract is around $30,000
to $35,000 a year. How much does one of these sweepers cost?
The one that's represented there at last year's price was $155,000.
And they last how long?
The one we have is an 88 and it's still on the road, so.
So there you go, you pay for yourself in the first 5 years.
Yes. I mean, a lot of towns, they do it like a rental purchase. They keep the sweeper for 5 years. They pay a rental fee. They have the option to purchase.
Which, but what I'm not pointing to is the 155, you would get rid of the 35 per year contract, correct?
Oh, absolutely, yes.
So you would pay for yourself in, what, 5 or 6 years?
Over a short period of time, yes.
And then for the next 5 or 10 years, we'd be zero on that balance.
Right, and you just have the maintenance upkeep of that, which is minimal by comparison.
Right.
Okay, next, you have a truck replacement reserve again. That's something you do over the years.
That there's this is the most critical thing I think in the equipment line of the budget, because right now we have 9 plow routes and I've only got 8 trucks available this year. The mechanics are trying to take two pieces of equipment that are out of service and make one good piece of equipment out of it. And so we're at a critical crossroad with equipment replacement. There is a truck that's tentatively scheduled, and we'll be talking to the Board of Selectmen tomorrow night about that. With the proposed purchase, the numbers that are represented are going to have to be adjusted to offset that. At the time these figures were put together, we didn't have all our prices in place. And the budget request would probably go up about $5,000 from the request in the upcoming budget year. But the need of a truck replacement, particularly the plow trucks, every truck that we have, I've got 4 trucks that are on the verge of being replaced, not necessarily by age, but by condition. I have 2 92s that are actually the out-of-service trucks now, and I still have an 88 that's in there, 90 and a 91 that are reaching that roadworthiness crossroad. That, you know, right now, they could be sidelined this season, for that matter.
because of the condition. Mechanics have been doing a remarkable job. Maintenance upkeep, but the biggest thing they're up against is parts availability.
Can you explain to me, just for the record, why does a dump plow truck cost $500,000?
I'm sorry?
Why does the truck cost $500,000, just for the record?
No, that's the $500,000 is for all the trucks.
All the trucks?
You have a whole 6-year plan. Okay. The average single axle is about...
How many trucks is that then?
It's 5 trucks.
Five or
four trucks.
I'm sorry.
We got 1, 2...
Four dumps.
Four dumps.
Four dumps.
One by some piece, roughly.
Okay.
Still expensive.
They're going up. We've got price quotes monthly are changing because of steel and fuel costs. And they're taking $3,000-$4,000 jumps at a time.
They only have $1,000 per year on their...
Well, that was projected cost, and when I, you know, look at some of the state bid pricing, the way they did it this year is they built in the escalation cost right into the contract, but they're leaving an open-ended clause for steel adjustment. So, you know, nobody's locking in at a fixed price, even though it's a state award. Some of the vehicles that I'll be talking about tomorrow night, we're actually doing better trying to price the vehicles on our own. So we use that as a guideline because most of the equipment that's being requested is incorporated. We don't have to rewrite a specification. It's built into the state bid. There's certain options that we use that they don't. And so we mix and match those components to meet our needs, but we often find that we can get a better deal than the state bid pricing. Years past, that was not the case. We used to do it just the other way. We used to go out and advertise for bids, not get a truck that was built component to component to meet our needs. So we started following the state bid purchase. Now we deviate because for whatever reason, whether it's the truck builders and the component builders are becoming more hungry for business, they're being more competitive with their pricing.
Okay. Any questions on the trucks? Okay, water bridge reserve, yeah, that's bridges and so forth, culverts.
Yeah, something
we do pretty much.
We have a reserve now for the Barrett Avenue Bridge.
We had that at $145,000 last year. Now we're at $450,000. I thought we looked at this and we didn't think we needed it, and that's why we dropped it.
Well, there's projects that are still...
We're gonna need it. I'm asking why. Last year we...
The Barrett Avenue Bridge is included in this proposal. Right. We're going to get 80% reimbursement by the federal government.
So this is not being offset by what we're going to get back?
Last year there was no incorporation of the Barrett Avenue Bridge. This year it includes a 20% match that we have to pay for against an 80% reimbursement from the federal government for replacement of the bridge. So that's why there's...
And that's how much?
It's 300,000.
Our end is 300,000?
Yeah. The total is what, Warren? 1.7?
Yeah, that was the preliminary estimate, yeah.
It has over 3 years, so you're not planning to do this project in 2011?
Yeah, well, by the time you apply right away, the grants, everything goes through, they said 3 years.
Minimal.
Small bridge.
That's with a throttling.
It's not even a signature bridge.
At least it's not a bridge.
We got a little bird on it or something.
That's true.
The big benefit is this is federally assisted, so it's...
How many bridges are there in Woodbridge?
There's roughly, as far as the bridges go, actual bridges, I think there's 5.
5?
Yeah. You know, we share borders with Bethany on 2 of them. And they picked up one of them, we picked up the other one. But we have smaller bridges. We have nothing that's large span. So this is the last of all the bridges that have been updated.
I was going to say, Bradley Road, that one was done. Right?
Bradley Road, was, yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, no.
Sanford Road was
isn't
done.
Isn't what's new the Sunbrook Road here?
That's something that's still, that's not new. That's been a project that's been in design. It's gone through all the approvals. We're in the final stages. We're just working on land easement access on that, and then it's to solicit the contractors. It's got to go out to bid. So that's a pending project, and that the dollars that are in there, of course, we're probably figuring that project is going to come in less than that, as far as cost, but we don't know. And that's, that money that's there has been a buildup of a reserve over a period of years, that we didn't just ask for that in one year.
And that's one we've toured this summer.
So are we saying that the $450,000 waterway reserve, we're going to get how much back from the government? It's not on the sheet, Tom?
No, of the $450,000 reserve, part of that is 300, it's actually if you're looking at the total funding over a period of years.
The $450,000 is a buildup of our it's a combination of buildup inclusive of the Merritt Avenue, the Sunbrook Road Bridge, or culvert rather, and then the waterways maintenance that we've been building up each year. We do, some remedial work on drainage, swales, washouts, hardening, dredging.
No, but are we going to get money back, you said?
No, our share of the Merritt Avenue is about $300,000. Our share.
Right.
Out of a million plus.
Oh,
million. That $300,000 has got to come out of this account.
Right.
Next is the road construction reserve.
Warren, there was a hope expressed that Sunbrook might just come down to the headwalls and that the culvert would be all right. Has that
Those options were looked into, and the engineer made a recommendation that the barreling in the pipe, the biggest problem there is water has been passing underneath the pipe, so the structure to the road is being affected by that. If you remediate the end walls at that time, now you've got other complications to set in. So the recommendation was to remove the existing type of structure, which is concrete pipe, and go into a box culvert design.
That would be concrete.
But there's no restrictions because there's no minimal joints. There's probably two joints on the passage of this road, where each pipe is an 8-foot segment right now, and that we're getting settling underneath the pipe. So it's not that the pipe is going into failure, but the support for that pipe is going into failure, and it's actually reaching the road surface. So ultimately, joint failure will occur. So if you remediate just the end walls, you still have the possibility of water that's done its damage. And if you start putting traffic onto the road, the pipe structure now becomes compromised, and it becomes more costly to remediate because you've already reconstructed the end walls. Those options were looked at by the engineer, and the recommendation was to replace it all.
And this will be at a height which will hold any flood that comes through?
Flooding hasn't been a problem there in the past. I mean, waters have risen around the mouth of the pipes, but usually due to restrictions. Hydraulic analysis was done of the area, and since we haven't had any overtopping of the road, there was the box culvert, as far as flow capacity, will meet or exceed what's currently there.
Because I know how much water I send down into that.
Right.
And the pond beyond that road, and that property does flood. But it's just because he's got a series of ponds there.
Yeah, and that's obviously any swelling of the waterways, the ponds are restricted by their banks, and the banks will overtop because if the pond silts in, that pond was dredged maybe 5 or 8 years ago, but I understand from the property owner that it's starting to silt in again. And a lot of that comes from the scouring that takes effect along the walls of the drainage passages themselves. There is some scouring at the end wall locations that has resulted in current damage to the structures. That's why the end walls themselves, besides the weathering impacts, the failure to what's on the road is due to the lack of installation of this, like the culvert, or to defer the water to the pipe as opposed to letting it pass underneath.
So we've never had a flow over a
road summit. No road overtopping over there.
Okay. Thank you, Mel.
Okay, next is road construction reserve. Are there any discussion on that?
Yeah, I do, because we had knocked this down, and we didn't knock it down. We had $500,000 from 08-09, we had $550,000 from 09-09. I mean, we're up $300,000.
right, this, the, over the, this year, I've requested an increase from previous budgets for several reasons. There has been an overall increase because of oil prices and the cost of asphalt product, but there's also been an increase in installation services attached to the road work from any reclamation or things and you know, anticipated costs. But more importantly, the infrastructure of our roads itself. I said in the past that because the town didn't have, we had a sand seal maintenance system to our roads, which worked effectively for the time period. But most of our roads that are still sand sealed are structurally deficient. And some of the operations that we have to use are forced to use the higher cost of maintenance alternatives. We use a combination of work. We overlay, we chip seal, we crack seal to preserve what we have. But we are reaching a point where the roads that are declining are roads that leave us no choice because there isn't, the sand seal doesn't have an adequate base. The substructure of the road by design meets or exceeds current standards. But the pavement itself is not structurally adequate and it's not very thick. So to do a milling operation on a sand sealed road, for instance, there isn't enough pavement there. So if we overlay the road, we're basically not getting the dollars worth of longevity for our effort going into the roads. We're getting, let's say, an 8-year maintenance life out of a road that we would overlay, where you should be getting at least 15, 20 years. So, well, you spend a little bit more to do the job right initially, instead of, yeah, they look cosmetically correct, but they're not going to give you structural longevity. And it's a combination, you have to make choices, and I think it's throwing good money after bad if you just improve a road without doing it right.
Is there any money left?
Road reserve?
Yeah, there's no sheet.
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly.
Exhaust.
Oh, sorry.
I was going to say $40,000 to $50,000 is still left from this year.
Yeah, small amount of
money. We generally spend it every year.
Right.
Yeah. As we move from year to year, you have a complete idea of what roads you're going to do in that particular year.
Oh, yes. Giving us a list of roads shortly.
Yes. In fact, I have with me tonight a projection. Of course, you have to scrutinize the roads prior to the paving season. And everything is contingent upon pricing, both what the boards approve for us to spend, and then come June of next year when prices become available for our purchasing, because our asphalt suppliers and the state bid pricing for our vended services doesn't come out until usually mid-June. But you still have to have a plan in place, and I'm trying to work on us staying at least 2 to 3 years ahead on tentative a plan, so that we know what direction we're going in. And that's why the request, if you looked at my previous 6-year plans, there's always been an increase going up, spending about $600,000 a year, knowing because of the type of services. This year, I think that we utilized a service that was just more milling than reclamation, and we've got a significant amount of roads improved. They're gonna last this probably somewhere in the middle of that time period that I just informed you about. But the roads that are on the proposed list require the more expensive work. And it's not that the reclamation work is more expensive, but you're using more asphalt product. You're using two layers of asphalt instead of one.
Warren, to reiterate something I've said in the past, we actually spend more than this on roads because the labor factor of the men in the public works department is in our operating budget. In other words, you use those guys.
That's just right.
Like, this is just for the, so no, if somebody asks how much you spend on roads, it's more than $600,000.
Well, what's not in here is all the landscape services right. that the men provide. We have line painting. There are things in the total budget that Tony sees.
There's operating dollars for the operating.
The catch basin.
Yeah, there's the operating dollars for repair.
Yeah, I mean the structures. Well, because we not only when we do a road over, many people think we're adding drainage to a road. That is not the case. We are replacing the covers on the road because they're the ones that are out exposed to the weather and the plows and everything else. But we pull those covers off and we actually check the integrity of the catch basin.
we're rebuilding those catch basins as necessary.
Right.
The only thing that's not done is the pipe replacement under the road that runs from one catch basin to the other. Very seldom is that necessary. There are some cases where we have to pull out pipe and replace it, but if we know that, we do it ahead of time. But at least the cover structures, if you're putting a new road surface, you don't want to dig it up to change the defective catch basin cover down the road. So we found it best to replace the majority of the catch basins. If they're good, we leave them. Why spend money on them? But we do rebuild catch basins, you know, check the integrity, and replace the covers as necessary. So that's all built into the capital.
So this $600,000 primarily represents material, and if we pay a contractor to do the
contractor and put the material in place and the purchase of the asphalt. And one of the big dictating factors I found this year is because what I budgeted for last year, we took almost a $12 a ton hit on the cost of asphalt. And you know, we put down thousands of tons of asphalt. So you know, average is 1,000 ton a day. So we might do 5 days worth of paving. So you know, if you do it, that's the meat of the budget, product costs.
Okay.
Thank you.
Finally, I guess you have a specific request in here for finishing Peck Hill Road.
Yes, like the Merritt Avenue Bridge, there is a shared cost because of the percentage split. The estimate on the job was $1.2 million, and our share cost, because of the financial spread, was $120,000. So by the time this project goes into the finalization, that will be our end cost.
It's a state grant reimbursement for work. Why don't you just a brief explanation of what's going to be done on that?
Well, the initial concept unit from DOT, when they looked at the project, there's several things. And sight line and grade are the two important factors of Peck Hill. At the intersection of Old Quarry.
Make a level.
So what they want to do, it's not going to be road realignment, it's going to be more of an elevation change.
Okay. Is this a stretch that runs in front of the subdivision?
No. This is further south than that.
Where it comes down and then you can't see.
If you're going along the road right now, Old Quarry is actually blind, and you can't see any oncoming traffic.
Right.
So the concepts unit's design on this was to lower the profile of the mouth of the intersection of Old Quarry so that you have a better line of sight and visibility of the intersection. It will have minimal impacts on the abutting properties, but it's necessary in order to do this. You know, if it was just pavement, we would have done something about it already, but they felt that for safety reasons, that's the plan. Now, the design engineer that we've selected and approved by the state has to come up with a final design. It doesn't necessarily have to meet, but it has to certainly follow a certain percentage of guideline because certain factors can't be changed. But they will come up with a final plan.
You're looking to this in the summer of 2010 or summer of 2009?
Actually, the project probably won't be finalized by the time we go through design approvals, bid awards, and the state has to look at everything and they have to sanction it. So by the time we get everything back and actually have a contractor in place, it's going to be 2010, 2011 before it actually gets constructed.
Excruciatingly slow process.
Wow.
Okay, any other questions for Warren?
I like the way you presented this budget, actually. It was, you know, especially with showing the reserves. It actually nice, at least it's something similar to sort of follow.
Yeah.
The money a little bit better. I was having a little time to police, but this was much easier to follow. So
well,
did you do this?
I supplement this because some of the questions that you may have and my ability to explain it to all of you as a group, if I break it down a little bit more, it might be more simplistic to follow what the intent is.
Yeah, it was good. I was easy to follow. Appreciate that.
Okay.
Just a matter of point, if you look at, if you have this, by the way, on the bottom of the pages for the capital budget, now that I screwed up, it says, also, the amounts in years 2009 to 2013 contain approved amounts only, which is why I am concerned.
So you and I agree. Yeah, we're up. some language to have people understand that's what I think.
Yeah, picked that up.
That's surely not the case.
No.
You really can't approve anything beyond the current.
Well, I understand, but what I'm, you know, this comes up when you go to even a commission meeting.
Yeah.
I mean, when these numbers are seen, whether it be by a resident, obviously if a resident even sees that, that they would think that we approved it. But even a board and commission, you go to a board and commission meeting and they think it's been stamped, and I'm just saying it.
Well, I guess to present it to the town, we approved the
right, the report or plan.
The report or the plan,
right.
We haven't approved the dollars. So we'll make it clear.
Tony, I'll work. That's the intent behind that, was that you've approved the 6-year plan.
Yeah, we've approved the 6-year plan, but we'll have to make it clear that we have not. You can't commit the town to money in the future years.
Right.
You can't do that. Yeah, but you can't do that. I mean, I know people don't understand that, but you can't commit the town to monies beyond the 1 year.
Right.
So.
I mean, the purpose of all this is for sound fiscal planning. That's why it's.
I remember we got into the discussion about leasing.
Plan over time.
About leasing a fire truck. Really, we can just lease a fire truck, and if the townspeople vote down the second payment, we have to turn the truck around. You can't go. You can't approve the payments for that lease. I mean, it's never going to happen, but you can't commit the town to anything beyond the current year. So.
Whenever you do a lease that's more than 1 year, whether it be a copy or a postage sheet, this is called non-appropriation of funds clause.
Yeah, exactly.
And
we're on the hook of regardless, even if you don't approve.
Yeah.
So. No one's going to do business with you.
Okay, so our next meeting now is Thursday, the 6th of December. You guys meet tomorrow night?
Yes, tomorrow.
Lucky you.
Warren will be back tomorrow night with another
question.
Right.
Good.
Okay. See you then.
Warren, thank you for everything. Good job.